My name is the Reverend Nigel Irons, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here to St Edward's Church in Leek for our all-age celebration service on this fourth Sunday of Epiphany, which we begin by using our opening responses. If you'll join in the words in white. Let us worship God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Because Jesus died for us, we thank you and praise you. Because Jesus rose again, we thank you and praise you. Because Jesus loves us, we thank you and praise you. Because Jesus is alive, we thank you and praise you. And now we'll join in singing our first song. Let us say together, Lord, direct our thoughts and teach us to pray. Lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we come to confess our sins, trusting in the mercy of our Heavenly Father, as we join in saying together, Lord Jesus, I know that I have things to say sorry for. I am sorry that I was not always kind last week. I am sorry that I was not always helpful last week. I am sorry that I got cross sometimes last week. I'm sorry that I hurt people who care about me last week. Please help me to be different this week. Help me to be more like you, Jesus. Amen. So may God, our Heavenly Father, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song we will praise our God. And now we'll join in singing our second song.
Teach me to walk in the light of your presence. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Teach me to love with your heart of compassion. Teach me to trust in the word of your promise. Teach me to hope in the day of your coming. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. You wrote the love.
a great and wondrous sign appeared in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet and a crown of 12 stars on her head. She was pregnant and cried out in pain as she was about to give birth. Then another sign appeared in heaven, an enormous red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on his heads. His tail swept a third of the stars out of the sky and flung them to the earth. The dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth, so that he might devour her child the moment it was born. She gave birth to a son, a male child, who will rule all the nations with an iron scepter, and her child was snatched up to God and to his throne. The woman fled into the desert to a place prepared for her by God, where she might be taken care of for 1,260 days. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So let's just pray for a moment before we think about that passage. Heavenly Father, we pray now that as we come again to reflect on your words to us, that you would give to each one of us ears to hear, minds to understand, and hearts to receive your truth. In Jesus' name, amen. So here's a very wealthy man checking his text messages. He gets one from his ex-girlfriend, which says, "Dear Mike, since I broke up with you, I can't sleep or eat anymore. I miss you so much. Maybe we can get together again. I love you. Carol." P.S. Congratulations on winning this week's lottery rollover. We all like the idea of winning, don't we? Not necessarily the lottery, of course, because as Christians, we may wisely choose not to gamble. But the concept of winning, of overcoming an opponent in some way, shape or form, of coming out on top, is deeply satisfying. And that's especially true when it's due to the applications of our own skills or gifts or ability or strategy or determination, rather than just random luck. Of course, on a more consequential level in our world today, Vladimir Putin is hoping to gain victory in his war against Ukraine, and Benjamin Netanyahu in his fight against the terrorist organization Hamas. We may well have mixed feelings about those conflicts and the manner in which they are being conducted. But if we go further back in history, we can perhaps recognize the sheer joy and relief and the overwhelming sense of thankfulness that must have been experienced by those in this country at the end of the First World War and of the Second World War. The fight was over, the victory secured, at least for the foreseeable future. One of the important things that the Bible does is to make clear that we all live in a battle zone as human beings. We are caught up in the fight between good and evil, which manifests themselves in an innumerable variety of different forms, and whose forces are led by God on the one hand and by Satan, the devil, on the other. And Satan, of course, is personified in the Garden of Eden story as the serpent. He personally comes to tempt Jesus when Jesus spends those 40 days in the wilderness. Both of these spiritual beings have some kind of authority. They have a supporting army of angels, as our passage from Revelation said. The devil has angels as well as God, available to do their bidding. And the Bible occasionally gives us glimpses of this unseen war that is taking place in the spiritual realm all around us. And here in Revelation chapter 12, we find a powerful narrative that speaks into the cosmic struggle between good and evil, light and darkness. It is an epiphany of the power of our Lord God Almighty, a presage of the final victory that we are promised he will most certainly win. And to understand this passage, sometimes when we're confronted with these passages with lots of imagery in them, we find them difficult to understand. But to understand this, it helps if we can recognize the symbolism that it contains and who the different characters in this vision, which was recorded by the Apostle John, represent. The woman is widely understood to represent the Virgin Mary. And the child she carries is, of course, Jesus himself. The reference to her being clothed with the sun indicates the radiance of the glory of God's presence, which is both within her and around her. In this season of Epiphany, we are reminded that where Jesus' presence is, his glory shines around. And that today we, as his church, the body of Christ on earth, are called to be those through whom his glory still continues to shine. The fiery red dragon is a symbol of evil and of the devil himself, the adversary who's always working to thwart God's plan. The seven heads and ten horns signify the devil's authority and power. And his appearance as an enormous dragon symbolically suggests that fierce power and his malevolent and murderous nature. His attempt to devour the woman's child at birth represents the forces of darkness trying to overcome the light. And it's specifically paralleled in Herod's attempt to eliminate Jesus after he'd been born by sending his soldiers to kill every male child in Bethlehem who was under 2 years old. And that was the work of the devil. But of course, the devil didn't stop there. Ultimately, he sought to extinguish the light of Christ by arranging for his crucifixion, out of which came the dramatic and ultimate victory as he rose victorious. Epiphany reminds us that the light of Christ exposes the works of darkness and reveals them for what they truly are. There is collateral damage in this story as the dragon's tail sweeps a third of the skies out of heaven and throws them to the earth, just as there was collateral damage in the hundreds of infants' lives that were lost in the slaughter of the innocents, and of course in the slaughter of many innocent lives in our world today. The child who's born to the woman, as we have already noted, is Jesus Christ himself, the Saviour of the world. He is destined, John writes, to rule all nations with a rod of iron, symbolizing his ultimate and overarching authority and sovereignty. And the imagery of the child being caught up to God's throne can be seen as signifying Jesus' victorious ascension and resurrection. Epiphany brings us the revelation of Christ's divine nature and his victory over sin and death. The woman's flight into the wilderness for protection is often seen to represent the flight of Mary along with Joseph and Jesus to Egypt. They were kept safe in Egypt until the death of Herod, which some commentators suggest was about 3 or 4 years later. And that time scale is interesting because John tells us in his vision that the woman was kept in a place of refuge prepared by God for 1,260 days, which is about 3.5 years. During Epiphany, we are reminded that even in the midst of difficulties and dangers, God is still in charge, and he will ultimately secure his sovereign purposes and make sure that the course of events works out so that his will in the end be done. Some commentators also identify the woman with the community of believers. Mary, of course, was the first believer in Jesus Christ when she was told that she was going to give birth to him. And so in that sense, she represents the church itself. And that's what makes her a target after the birth of Jesus. John was writing at a time when the church was undergoing huge suffering and persecution. He himself was in exile because of that. And he's writing to his fellow Christians with the message that just as the devil sought to eliminate the Messiah before he was born or shortly afterwards, so now he is seeking to eliminate the church which was founded by Jesus himself. So this vision is a depiction of war. And it was given to John by God to reassure his people that although they were undergoing great suffering, their time of hardship would ultimately come to an end. God is showing us the future. And what he reveals is that the ultimate outcome of all the battles that will ever take place in the history of our world will be that he will overcome. He will have the victory. He will win. He has the final word. And that truth is of enormous encouragement to every Christian who finds the going tough, who suffers from injustice or persecution. Our Heavenly Father wants us to know that when evil appears to be on the ascendancy, and it looks as though it's gaining the upper hand, which sometimes it does, we can still be sure that the devil will never ultimately win, that the final outcome of the battle is secure in God's hands because of the finished work of Jesus Christ, which stands for all time and can never be diminished, compromised, or robbed of its eternal value. Jesus is Lord, and nothing will ever materially affect or change that. His throne is established, and one day every knee will bow before him. Those who recognize, acknowledge, and serve him as King through whatever troubles this world brings will one day rejoice in the glory and security of his eternal kingdom, where his rule and reign will be final and utterly unchallenged. That is the Christian hope. And it's a hope that once we grasp it, has the power to sustain us on every single step of our journey of life and faith, and to encourage and affirm our trust in God until that day when we stand in the company of every saint who has ever lived, seeing Jesus face to face and giving him with open hearts the glory that he deserves. God wants us to know this assurance. He has shown it to us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He is the victor, and we can trust him to be our Saviour. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your absolute power over all creation and for your eternal plans and purposes which cannot be thwarted. Encourage us where we are downcast and lift our eyes to see your glory afresh. Jesus, thank you that you have won the victory over sin, death, hell, and all the forces of evil, and that you lead your people to triumph. Support us in our own struggles and dispel any darkness that seems to surround us. Holy Spirit, thank you that your mighty power sustained and strengthened Jesus in his earthly life and raised him from the dead. Uphold us by that same power and affirm in us the sure and certain hope of his eternal kingdom. Amen. And now we'll join in singing our third song.
Let me
So now we'll use the responsive version of the Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Jesus known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So, Heavenly Father, you are our teacher. You gave us your Son, Jesus Christ, so that we could learn more about you. We've been blessed by his teaching, his healing, and his caring ministry among us. And that ministry is continued and extended through the Holy Spirit, who is present with us today. Help us to reach out to your truth and hold on to your presence. Heavenly Father, hear our prayer. We pray that you'll bring your church today a full understanding of our mission and purpose. We pray for our archbishops, bishops, priests, deacons, and all church leaders, that you will entrust them with a vision for the future and an appreciation of the past as they exercise their responsibility for the present. And help St. Edward's, our own church here, to play its full part in your purpose for our community. Heavenly Father, hear our prayer. We pray to your troubled world, for your troubled world, that you would bring your healing and renewing grace to rest upon all those places where trouble and danger and suffering exist. Encourage us to use natural ways that you have provided, rather than continuing with the willful misuse of our planet. Encourage mutual trust between nations where this is needed, and create in our own nation the desire and the will to be inclusive in our nationhood, to be a good neighbor to other places in need. Heavenly Father, hear our prayer. We pray for everyone who is suffering as a result of the forces of evil gaining the upper hand at this present time, for all places of conflict, war, and oppression, where the greed for power and territory overwhelms all other considerations. We pray, Father, for all those aid agencies reaching out to help them in their troubles, that you'll provide them with the resources that they need, and that you'll give us generous hearts to support them and to pray for their work. We pray for all those speaking out for peace, that you'll give them wisdom in all their negotiations, and that their voices will be heard and heeded. Heavenly Father, hear our prayer. We pray for everyone we know who's poorly at this time, suffering in body, mind, or spirit. We pray that they will feel your love as they seek to recover with the help of those around them, and that those caring for them, visitors, friends, and family, will show patience and strength. We pray for those who are dying, that they will know the comfort and the peace of your unfailing presence. And for those who mourn the loss of loved ones, that you'll bring them comfort and solace amidst their grief. Heavenly Father, hear our prayer. And so we pray that you would strengthen each one of us on our individual journeys of life and of faith, that you would enable us daily to recognize the power and the presence of your love, to receive that love, to share that love, and to learn to live in the light of that love until that day when you establish your final victory, and together with all your people, we will rejoice in the glory of your eternal kingdom. Heavenly Father, hear our prayer. And now we join together in saying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And now we'll join in singing our final song.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song again, whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on saying. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like this. Worship your holy name. Bless you, time has come.
Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
So we join in our final prayer. Jesus, thank you that you died on the cross for my sin. Thank you that you rose again so that I can have eternal life. And thank you that you are here with me now so that I can live for you every day. Amen. So now, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and in the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the rich, overflowing blessing of God the Father who created us, God the Son who has redeemed us, and God the Holy Spirit who breathes God's life, light and love into our hearts, rest upon you, remain with you, guard you, guide you, keep you and strengthen you in his service today and always. Amen. Thank you for joining us for our service of all age celebration. We look forward to you taking the opportunity to join us again, if you're able to, next week for our service of morning prayer.